Geometry, ninth standard geometry, that's what I'm looking at. So first of all, you have to correct the false history and the bad philosophy, science in our school texts. So this backward integrates the calculus with string geometry, which was used by Egyptians, by Indians in the Shulba Sutra. That's the idea. It's called Rajju Ganit. And why are we doing it? Not because it is ingenious, not because it's a matter of pride, because it is better. Only because it is better. Not for any other reason. So calculus arose for this reason, that you want to measure a curved line. When you're talking about sine values, you're talking about measuring the circumference, the arc. And how do you measure it? How do you measure it with a compass box? The arc of a circle. Can't do it. You talk of rectifiable arcs, you have to introduce integrals and so on. Can't do it just like that. You can measure it with a string. That's the advantage of the shulba, which is a string. And this is missing in the geometry box. So my current proposition is throw away the geometry box. Throw away also this notion of invisible points. If you can see them, throw them away. If you can't see them, ignore them. They won't hurt you in any way. And it has no instrument with which to measure a curved line. It's just something which we are imitating. And the measurement of a curved line is needed even to define an angle. Ask students, why do you use that protractor? Angle is something between two straight lines. Why do you need a circular instrument to measure it? They don't understand. Supposing I take a bigger instrument, will it change the angle? If not, why not? They don't. So all this is made easy. The problem is that current school teaching teaches miserable nonsense. It conflates different types of geometry. Hilbert came up with a synthetic geometry to justify the myth of Euclid. What does synthetic mean? You see, superposition is disallowed. How do you measure length? You measure length by taking a ruler, putting it on a line segment. If it is disallowed, you cannot measure length. If you cannot measure length, your geometry is not metric, it is synthetic. That's Hilbert's synthetic geometry. So you teach Hilbert synthetic geometry, but you also teach the compass box. So you are teaching two contrasting geometries which make no sense. Totally confuse people. You know, they'll say, NCERT text will say, ideally a ruler should be unmarked. So what should the student do? Erase all the markings on the ruler and the compass box? Generating confusion. So that is what happens. So teaching quad geometry leads to conceptual clarity about point, angle, arc, etc. And I have tried to eliminate this, and the teachers have understood, they have acknowledged that they have a problem, that they have conceptual confusion, they are not able to teach it during workshops. So this was an assignment. Now I cannot amplify it because the thing is there. But the point is there are these five different types of geometry. Hilbert synthetic geometry, Birkhoff's axiomatic metric geometry, so-called Euclidean geometry, compass box geometry, which is empirical, and the geometry of the Shulba Sutra. So I asked them to compare and so on. This was part of their home assignment. So it is there on the net, ckraju.net/geometry. Please try their home assignment. So these are the teachers in Nasik, teachers and students. And this is, I can only show you photos, right? Chamrajnagar, teachers and students. These students are a bit too young. They did have a little problem. This is the teachers, they were so happy, they asked for a repeat workshop, Gundulupet. And this is the textbook, which is getting ready, almost ready. And my conclusions are fairly simple. We need to throw out these falsehoods, which have been put in with a vested interest. And we certainly don't need, if the text cannot be justified, it must be corrected. Problem is, if people don't fight, that's not going to happen. So our children need to understand the West stole not only wealth, it stole knowledge. And a whole lot of knowledge it stole before it stole wealth. For 250 years, they were mining knowledge. And they did not digest all of it, they have digested it, gave us back something inferior in return, but taught us that it is superior, we believed it. So we must not be, our children must not be taught to wrongly imagine that the West is best. What they must be taught, that they must be critical and choose what is really the best. Be critical, it does not matter what you believe. Whatever is best, accept it, but what is not best, abandon it. And so we should abandon formal math and revert to normal math. Thank you very much. I'm sorry I overshot my time. Yes, please. Questions? Yes. I'm expecting a lot of them. Yes. Madam wants to ask a question. Yes.
Sir, nowadays in a classroom, teaching trigonometry is becoming big, difficult. How can we teach it easily?
Oh, it's very easy, no, if you do it this way. So but why is trigonometry difficult? First of all, you define some opposite side upon hypotenuse. The word hypotenuse itself is so big, a lot of people get pushed off right there. You have difficulty. Now, if you are teaching this as jiva, teaching it as the arc of a circle, and teaching children to learn, I can show you some videos of children learning to measure using a string. They don't have any conceptual problem. So once they don't have any conceptual problem, once they can calculate, so that's the part of the Calculus Without Limits course, and that is part of the trigonometry course, how to calculate, say, sine of 1 degree. This incidentally was a question that my son asked me when he was in 8th standard. And so I had to answer, and those days there were no long distance phones, so I had to answer on trunk call. And I did my best. So that's the idea, that you are basically using Aryabhatta's method is that of linear interpolation. Later on, Bhatteshwar and so on used quadratic interpolation, Brahmagupta used quadratic interpolation and so on. So there's a very easy way of doing it if you do it like this. And after that, people don't have any difficulty with trigonometry ever in their lives. It's not trigonometry, it is circle metry. Measuring the circle, not a triangle. So there is an easy way, that is what the Raju Ganit book has got. And if you are using a string, it becomes very simple. Right? So would you like to join this group and test it out? So you are most welcome. Right? So there is an easy way to do it. And once you derive those trigonometric values like that, you don't have difficulty in future.
But is it possible in the 40 minutes teaching?
Yes, it is possible because I demonstrated that with the students in 3 days, that they do learn it in 3 days. The 9th standard students, 8th standard students have a little problem. So it's not one lecture of 40 minutes. You are teaching trigonometry over several lectures. So it is certainly possible, and we are actually conducting experiments in Nasik for the teachers to teach. These experiments were to have been done three months ago. They got a little delayed. So they are actively being done. And you can take the book and try teaching it yourself. The problem is of a different sort. Problem is not that of students' understanding. The problem is that of the administrative system. The teachers have a problem because what they say, you are teaching us this way of doing it, we agree. But what we are teaching is opposite to what the textbook says, contrary to it. How do we do that? This is where the problem comes. Similar question cropped up in Kamala Nehru College. You are teaching us, no, all that we learnt in 14 years is all wrong. Yes. So what has to be done? You have to retrain. All right? What you have to do is, first of all, examine it yourself. Be convinced that what is being taught today is complete nonsense. Now, complete nonsense, as I said, Hilbert synthetic geometry being mixed up with compass box geometry. This is there in the NCERT text, which goes to millions of students. And nobody points out that it is totally incoherent. As that lady said, how are we teaching this nonsense for all these years? It is as if somebody had cast a spell on us. Now we understand it, we are, you know, completely amazed how we did it. So that's the issue. Once you understand, then it becomes clear that what is being done, Hilbert was just trying to save the myth of Euclid. And why are there so many propositions needed to prove the Pythagorean theorem, which can be proved in one step, even in axiomatic metric geometry. I showed you the proof in one step, it's empirical. So it is, the whole thing becomes very easy if you do it like this. If there is conceptual clarity and if there is no metaphysics, because you are doing it empirically, students can see what is happening. They don't have any difficulty. But how do you correct the administration? How do you correct the government? That is the problem, because the students can't change the syllabus, the teachers can't change the syllabus, the parents can't change the syllabus, and if you go to the officer in charge, he or she can't change the syllabus. The Babu can't change it, the Neta can't change it. Only person who's authorized to do it is somebody from Harvard or Cambridge. If you will see, our textbooks in geometry changed after the Sputnik crisis. US invested a lot of money into math teaching. Said, we are falling behind, we will be dead, and so on. And at that stage, the Yale Mathematics Study Group came up with a syllabus for geometry teaching. And they recommended Birkhoff's metric geometry and so on. And that is what is being taught today. That changed overnight. For example, you use the word congruence. Do you not? What is congruence and how does it differ from equality?
Only ratio.
Yes?
Ratio only.
No, see, equality is equality when you are putting one on top of the other. Congruence means you are not allowed to put one on top of the other. So that's a term used by Hilbert. And equality is prohibited. The original term was equality. He changed it. And we blindly copied it. Because he was setting up a justification for the Euclid myth. Why do we need such a justification? We need to learn geometry, right? Why do you want to get into this elaborate nonsense? Teach the students geometry. So let the West take care of its myths. We are not concerned. Right? So that is the problem. The problem is that people are ignorant, and because they are ignorant, they have been taught dependence. They have been taught that only experts can do it. They don't know who the experts are. For example, our government has appointed Manjul Bhargav. How do they know he's an expert? Because he got the Fields Medal. Somebody in the West rewarded him. He got a certificate from the West. Therefore, he's the right person. The problem. You are the right person. You think of it. And you say, I believe this. And that's what I want to do. I want to give a report to the government based on that.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
If you have more questions, you can ask. No problem.
Yes, sir. I have gone through a couple of your YouTube interviews. And I could understand that you have identified some error of Einstein. And can you just explain what was that?
Error of Einstein. See, I just said that Newton and physics failed. Why did Newton and physics fail? Because Newton did not have a measure of time. He made time metaphysical. He said it flows. How can it flow? In what will it flow? For it to flow, there must be another time in which it flows. Things can flow in time. Time itself cannot flow. So there was no measure of time. Now if you look at the statement of Newton's, let us say, second law of motion. Let's take first law. What does the first law state? Body stays in its state of rest or uniform motion in the absence of external forces. What is uniform motion? Equal distances in equal times. What are equal times? I grab 1 hour from the past, 1 hour from the future, put it in the present and compare it. Is that what I do? I cannot possibly do that, right? So what are equal intervals of time? You have to define it. Newton did not define it. Because he said, God knows. But if God knows, you cannot do physics that way. You have to know if you are doing. So, you want to define equal intervals of time, that is what Poincaré did. Einstein did not invent the special theory of relativity. Poincaré did it. And he said that you define equal intervals of time as a matter of convenience. Because there is no absolute way to define it. It's up to you. So, he defined it by saying the speed of light is constant. The speed of light is constant. You bounce a photon between two mirrors, parallel mirrors, and you get equal intervals of time. Whether you can do it or not, it's a secondary question. At least you have a conceptual definition of equal intervals of time, which you don't have. Newton noted, you know, swings of a pendulum are not equal, days and nights are not equal, and what is equal? There may not be anything which is equal, but God knows and I know that's good enough. So this definition of equal intervals of time which he gave was based on the speed of light being constant. If the speed of light is constant, then interactions cannot travel at a speed greater than that of light in one direction in time. So if your sun switches off, you should get to know about it only after 8 minutes. If you do that, the basic character of Newtonian physics changes. Newtonian physics is all about the solution of differential equations, ordinary differential equations. All right? The moment you change this, you have a delay. Something at a distance takes time to act. And therefore, the character of the differential equation changes, you get what are called functional differential equations. Einstein was not a mathematician. He did not understand. All right, so he thought that functional differential equations can be approximated by ordinary differential equations. That was a mistake. All right, so you have to work with functional differential equations. It makes a difference, the two-body problem, to the hydrogen atom, to gravitation. So I have a theory of gravitation which works with functional differential equations. What is the difference it makes? If you are looking at gravitation in Newtonian gravitation, the rotation of the earth is not going to affect anything. But if your speed applied is constant, you want to stick to that principle, the velocity of the object will also make a difference, a small difference, at the V by C level. So if the Earth is rotating, nearby spacecraft will experience a tiny effect. And this has been observed, it's contested, but it is observed, it's called the NASA flyby anomaly. Very tiny difference, extremely tiny. You know, when it comes in, the spacecraft comes in, it is going at about something of the order of 10 kilometers per second. And the effect we are talking about is something of the order of few millimeters per second. That's the change. So the very tiny effect, but it is observed very accurately, because you cannot make those observations accurately. So that is the idea, that if you change the nature of the differential equations, then the theory changes, theory of gravitation also changes, and so on. And Einstein didn't understand that. He thought one sort of thing can be approximated by the other. The fundamental difference is, one is history dependent, the other is instantaneous. A history-dependent process cannot be approximated by an instantaneous process. They are completely different, qualitatively different. That's also discussed in my book, 11 Pictures of Time. All right?
So, yeah. When we learned the mathematics, like in our engineering and plus two, till plus two, we learned many things. But when we come to the real life, there are only small things we are applying. So, do we need to change the textbook pattern we still follow? Like, many things has to be, like, you have written there, to be thrown out. How we can do that process?
Well, let's take, as I said, a very simple thing. I gave you a very simple example of the simple pendulum. Simple pendulum is the first experiment you perform. You don't have a theory for it because you lack the mathematical skills. You don't study the theory for it because you lack the mathematical skills, and therefore you teach children something wrong. Don't trust the experiment, trust the formula. Whereas science begins the other way. Trust the experiment, throw out the formula if it is wrong. So please take a look at this paper of mine, Time, what is it that it can be measured, on how much I had to fight for my kids, first one kid, then the second kid in school, the teachers. Because they don't understand. So what are you talking about? So I went and told the teacher for my younger kid that this is how it happened with the elder kid and so on. Got him interested in science, and so you should teach like that. So she listened to me patiently. The next day she told in front of the whole class, your father was talking nonsense. I just listened to him out of respect. He said, no, I checked it in the book and the book says this. So she checked it in the book. She never checked the experiment. She never performed the experiment. And the experiment is there, it's performed by my son. You can take a look, just Google simple pendulum time period, exact time period. You'll find his school report where the experiment is performed, where you can test it like this. So you are able to do things better. I gave you another example of how this actually improves. Now, what is the advantage? See, let's take a simple, another example. No, in college, I may not look at it like look like it now, but in college I was athletic champion. And one of the things in which events which I won was the javelin throw. Now the javelin throw, I threw it the first time, it went a certain distance and I was happy. Then I said, what is this? I am studying physics and I am throwing it wrongly. Actually, you should throw it at 45 degrees. That's when it will go high, as far as possible. And so I threw it at 45 degrees. It fell very, it was a very miserable failure. Then I said, let physics go to hell, let me throw it whichever way I like. And I threw it and I won the event. Now the point here is this, that this idea of 45 degrees is wrong. That's not true. If you want to throw a javelin, you don't throw it at 45 degrees. There are various things, there's airlift, in any case, there's air resistance and so on. But you don't model it because you don't have the mathematical tools to model it. If you take air resistance into account, for example, you know, Second World War, there was this gun, Big Bertha, which is to fire long distance. If you want the thing to go that long distance, you may want to fire it at 30 degrees, even if you are neglecting airlift just because of air resistance. So there are a number of such problems which you can do better if you have the proper mathematical tools. All right, so your argument cannot be that we should keep inferior mathematics just because we had it all along. You are not able to use the calculus because the calculus that you learned was useless. You were just taught formally. What is the formula for integration? What is the formula for differentiation? You are not taught to solve differential equations. In practice, you're all the time solving differential equations, and that's what I'm advocating. So it will help you in any practical problem of any sort. Let's say you want to streamline something. How will you do it? So you have to take a resistance into account. And for that, you have to have the appropriate tools, otherwise you won't know the theory. And therefore, the thing has to begin right from school, where you teach geometry differently, then you teach calculus differently, and then you start applying it in a different way because you have the tools to do that. And so you produce better, because when it becomes easier, you can do harder problems. Very simple. So elliptic integrals which you could not use, you can use now. It's very trivial. I hope you get the point.
Yes.
Or if
yes.
you disagree, please.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yes.
Higher secondary, in the starting of the calculus.
Yes.
So first we want to teach limits of a function. So within a small duration of time, how can we introduce that this limits? In the textbook it is lot of
limits. What I teach is calculus without limits. Why do you use limits? What are they needed for? What are limits? How can you explain limits? You cannot teach it in higher secondary. If you want to teach limits, you have to first of all teach the real numbers. Yeah. You want to teach real numbers, you have to teach set theory. You can't teach any of that.
So a lot of that illustrations is given there in
frustration.
The...
I agree.
Yes.
And what does the textbook say? We are not going to define limit, we will give an intuitive idea of the limit. Why? You can't define it, throw it away, you should be able to use it, no? So limits are not needed for anything and they just teach you this kind of nonsense. So this is calculus without limits. You don't need limits. You need zeroism, you need infinitesimals, which is what Brahmagupta did. Alright? So you work with approximations all the time. Any calculation you want to make will be approximate. Any engineering calculation, you cannot have it exact. Any scientific calculation cannot be exact. Alright? So forget about this myth of exactitude. Why are limits needed? You want the exact value. How do you know there is an exact value at infinity? Something else might happen at infinity. So that's the metaphysics of infinity, that you go to infinity, everything becomes perfect. That's the metaphysics we are talking about, and that's a false metaphysics. So you don't teach that false metaphysics, it's not needed, and we teach it purely out of imitation. How did Aryabhatta do it? How did Madhav calculate? Did he use limits? So he calculated, no? So people are able to run ships on it, no? They were able to navigate, they were able to calculate the radius of the earth, they were able to do everything. Why do you need limits? So this question you should ask. Why are you teaching this nonsense? I have never used it in my life. All right, I have also
a lot of confusion while teaching that limits, because all the whatever questions if they are asking, then it's very difficult to answer the questions.
Exactly. It is very difficult, and it's not your fault because you don't learn it either. Then you do it, you say I have a, you know, metric space and so on, and therefore in a metric, complete metric space, you have limits and things like that, and most people don't know it. In Malaysia, I had a postgraduate class whom I taught calculus without limits. So I said that since this is a postgraduate, these are postgraduate students, one was actually a PhD. I said, let me ask them some questions so that I can explain what is the philosophy of mathematics. So first question was define a complete metric space. Everybody flunked. Out of 36 students who registered, 18 dropped out of the course. Or some 17 dropped out of the course. And they were sitting in front of computers, they were Googling and they were looking at Wikipedia, what is a complete metric space, what is a Cauchy sequence, what is this, what is that, they couldn't answer. So they have no concept, even at that level. How can you teach it to high secondary students? You cannot teach it. And what is being done is this. You don't learn it, you don't understand it, you memorize it and jolly well put it in the exam, otherwise you are going to flunk, otherwise you are not going to get a job, otherwise you are going to drown, your career is finished, your life is finished and so on. These are the kinds of threats which are used to teach such complete nonsense like invisible points. You don't need limits. All right?
Okay.
So here you are just doing a concrete problem. I have, let us say, a simple pendulum, I am looking at its motion, or I have a javelin which I am throwing, I am looking at its motion and so on. Right? So you don't need limits for any of these problems, for any practical problem. Cannot use it.
Okay, sir.
Yeah?
Thank you.
So you must throw it away. That's my campaign.
Okay, sir.
All right?
Yes.